take the second one first. I think what's really going on is conformity.
Conformity, not information?
And fear. Conformity and fear in Congress, if that's what you're referring to. Fear to break the lockstep, fear to be odd person out.
Could you just say a little bit more about that? I don't understand. Fear to say, this is, fear to object to the people that are in Congress? I just don't understand how Congress can could be afraid of their own peers in that way.
Well, I mean, there are different explanations for it, but a big, let's take Democrats, for instance. Take my Democrats, please. Nancy Pelosi has tremendous power over what happens to Democrats in Congress, and they hope, of course, to get a majority in a couple of years. But even that aside, the minority leader in that case can assign subcommittee chairpersonships or ranking memberships or whatever to particular members of Congress. There are 101 different ways that the hierarchy can help or hurt members of Congress. And I don't know what's inside somebody's mind or heart, but I do know that sticking your neck out away from the party line that's coming from above is not a career enhancer inside the Congress.
So you're saying that Keith Ellison, Al Franken, and Amy Klobuchar have no spine? None of the three?
Well, I can only go on their actions and inactions.
Right.
And they're part of the war machine. In the case of Russia, the Russia polarization, those people you name, not to pick on them, but they are along the members of Congress who are, they're with the program.
Okay, let's take a few more questions right here in the front, and then I saw many more to come.
Yeah, isn't it that they're in the pockets of the corporation on the defense industry and things, and that's who they're appeasing with their votes? Nancy Pelosi, isn't it true she has a $4.5 million mansion and she spent her entire career in Congress? How did she amass all that money?
Did you want to say?
Well, I recently gave a talk about kind of about this topic.
Can you speak in the microphone?
This isn't to amplify my voice, this is to record my voice. I'm sorry, I'll try to speak up more. Okay. I gave a talk about effective lobbying, to talk to your congressman to try to get what you want. And the number one thing I was told from Indivisible. They have this guide about what works, a group of staffers that said this is what works. The number one thing they said, they stressed, was the only thing that members of Congress care about is being reelected. That's what they only listen to. They don't care if you're not their constituent, but that's the only way to be reelected is to have a lot of money. And even if you're incumbent in a safe seat, Peter DeFazio is my representative, he's very good in almost every issue, but he said he's constantly in campaign, raising money for campaigns. So the machine is broken. The Congress is not democratic at all, and we don't have access to our own representatives, and that's personally why I think it's going to take outside pressure to end the rope, you know, the military machine that we are as the United States. I don't think you and I have the power anymore to actually affect what happens in Congress. I think it has to come from outside. But that's their priority.
Yeah. So, something I'll just add and answer your question. I mean, like a lot of things in life, it's multifactorial. There are a lot of reasons why people in Congress behave the way they do, and certainly the contributions, they're part of it. But I think it's a key point. The most power we have is in the electoral arena, I believe, is as a constituent. And I'm not a big fan of writing to people hundreds or thousands of miles away telling them how to vote. I think what's crucial is, in this context, our own members of Congress. We have two senators, we have one representative, and we have an opportunity to really dig in there, and that can really change their approach. And if they, to take an extreme example, if ultimately they believe that we as activists in their district have lit such a fire under them on that issue, however we've done it, and it's either pardon the expression, pacify and satisfy the constituents, or go up against Nancy Pelosi, they would rather go up against Nancy Pelosi than lose potentially their next election. So I think, unfortunately, it's hidden in plain sight quite often that what we can do to have the most effect is to really dig in our own district and challenge our members of Congress.
Worth noting, Raytheon, which makes these missiles that Donald Trump reportedly owned stock in while sending them off to Syria and so forth, who can tell me when Raytheon's stock was the highest it's ever been in the history of Raytheon? I'm sorry?
Right after the launch?
No. 2013, when Barack Obama had made crystal clear that he was going to bomb the hell out of Syria. And that decision was reversed primarily by public pressure around the world, in the UK as well as here, not because Raytheon didn't want to make money that week, but because the balance of forces weighed in our favor for once. And it was not farthest thing from a complete victory. You know, we were even more against arming rebels and terrorists in Syria, and they went right ahead with escalating that. But stopping that bombing campaign was not a decision made by Wall Street. It was a decision made against Wall Street, which doesn't mean we aren't up against an incredibly unfair uphill climb. It just means sometimes we can win, so we damn well ought to try our hardest. Yes?
Yeah. I have a question about something that you said, Leah, in the beginning when you were talking about the University of Chicago survey. The question I have is, were the people that were surveyed, much like the people that are in this room today, in the 50s and older, Caucasian by and large, or was it really, or did the base that Trump calls his people, the base, were they surveyed as a part of this too? And the reason I'm raising that question is that after you made your comments about it, it sounded like it was pretty much skewed in as we might have voted, mm-hmm. but not necessarily as how the people who theoretically were on Trump's here. So could you address
that? Yeah, sure. Well, the National Opinion Research Center has been around for a long time. They're highly regarded. It's scientific poll. They ask over 2,000 people, and I don't know what the demographics were exactly. If they say we have to serve so many African Americans, I don't know that. But I do know that it's very highly regarded. They ask 2,000 people, and it's been the same results have been virtually the same for the last since 1973. So I don't know exactly how many people or if they divide it up, but I would think, guessing, because it's so highly regarded, that they get a balance, a distribution of people.
Well, my comment then after my question is simply this, that in my limited experience, the people that I love the most are in this room, but the people that I live with are hell-bent on war, hell-bent on guns. I live in a rural area in Alaska, and I know it's very small there, but that's the kind of people who I think represent the base and others for the Trump type of political. And I suggest to you that if the University of Chicago or any other surveyor would go specifically to the people on the ground, I think they might come up with some different answers. I really do. And I love the people here, that's why I'm here. But that's my thing to think. Hey there, Will.
Okay. Over here.
Leah, I wish that we could do an article in every major newspaper of the statistics and stories that you were tallying and what you were doing. And a music video next week that we could go for. And there are no just wars, only just causes. And Martin Luther King and Gandhi, you said peace or nonviolence is a strategy. I think nonviolence is a much more effective word. And we gotta be wordsmiths. And I just wish, could you each comment on that? About what experience you've had with that topic. I think peace is an overused word and people do not have the same idea what it means.
Yeah, I can respond too. I often say that there is a huge difference between peace and anti-war. The World Beyond War is an anti-war organization. And there are, because peace is so nebulous, what makes up peace, you know? Community gardens, wonderful thing, it's a peaceful thing to do, but doesn't, you know, it doesn't talk about war, it doesn't, you know, face war. So there's lots of peaceful things you can do and promote, and those are all wonderful things, and we would all love to have all of those wonderful things. But I think it's, for me, and what I want to do to change the world is get rid of war. And so that's the difference I see. World Beyond War wants to replace the war system that we have now, the global security system that's based on war and militarism, and is intertwined with the media and Congress and lobbyists and all these things that keep it going. We want to replace that system with ones based on international law and diplomacy and mediation. So in order to switch, to move this way, we've developed a blueprint, we call it, the Global Security Strategy, An Alternative to War, and that's the book that you can download for free on our website, World Beyond War. You can download for free. There are a few copies left here. And if you come to our conference in D.C. next month, we'll give you a copy for free of the third edition of it. But that's what we see, is we can't just say we're anti-war or we're pro-peace, because we have to find something to replace this system.
I'd add, too, that really, while word choice is so important, there's no one word or phrase that's going to appeal to everybody, and so often there'll be opposite reactions to the same phrase, thumbs up, thumbs down from different folks. So I think getting people's responses back and trying to be sensitive to people's concerns will help us to, if you will, fine-tune our message. David and I and others at Reaction have been developing a new campaign that will launch in a few weeks for diplomacy. And that's the word in life will be diplomacy. And we're hoping that that's a helpful sort of framework to then bring in the necessity to prevent wars and end the ones that are now going on. By the way, if there's anybody in the room who is not getting Roots Action Blast, I hope that you will sign up, and it's a way to be networking and taking action with others. Just go to rootsaction.org and enter your name and zip code, and you'll be all set.
And read the list.